Tonight on NewsWatch, a reality check. As the pressure increases for Libya's leader to step down, some question his sanity. Plus, a dangerous view. One court says a couple's stance on homosexuality makes them unfit parents. And opening their hearts. One group in Israel works to save children of all faiths from certain death. All this and more tonight on NewsWatch. Good evening, I'm Mark Martin. Libyan leader Muammar Gaddafi managed to hold on to one of his key cities today after a six-hour battle. His forces kept rebels out of a city that's just 30 miles from the capital. All this as Gaddafi denies the protests and insists his people love him. Dale Hurd has the latest in tonight's top story.
Despite anti-government protesters closing in around Muammar Gaddafi's capital city of Tripoli, the Libyan leader insisted to ABC News Christian Amanpour that there are no protesters in his country at all.
They love me, all my people with me. They love me all.
But if they do love you...
They will die to protect me and my people.
If you say they do love you, then why are they capturing Benghazi and they say they're against you there? Why are they in Zawiya?
It is Gaida, not my people.
Not a lot of love for Gaddafi and Benghazi, where one man said, we don't want him to leave, we want him to die.
He's crazy.
He lies and he knows he's lying.
UN Ambassador Susan Rice agrees, and she says so does much of the world.
The international community have joined the people of Libya in expressing their outrage at the killing and the slaughtering and the frankly crazy behavior that we've seen out of Colonel Gaddafi.
And Secretary of State Hillary Clinton issued a veiled threat.
We are taking no options off the table so long as the Libyan government continues to turn its guns on its own people.
Gaddafi says he has not ordered his own people killed, although the UN estimates hundreds, if not thousands, have died. The U.S. Treasury Department has frozen at least $30 billion in Libyan government assets, and U.S. naval and air forces are moving closer to his country.
Gaddafi has lost the legitimacy to govern, and it is time for him to go without further violence or delay.
In Geneva, U.S. allies are considering establishing a no-fly zone over Libya to protect rebel-held areas from attack by Gaddafi forces. Dale Hurd, CBN News.
Violence continues in other parts of the Middle East. In Yemen today, hundreds of thousands of protesters marched in an effort to convince their president to step down. Yemen is a key American ally in the fight against al-Qaeda. But today, Yemen's president accused Washington of instigating the protests. He said America was only interested in protecting Israel's security and stability. Meanwhile, in Iran, police used tear gas to break up anti-government protests in Tehran. The protesters are demanding the release of opposition leaders who were arrested yesterday. The situation in the Middle East is changing by the hour. CBNNews.com will have the latest headlines. Also, go to our special reports section for our Middle East crisis roundtable discussion. And be sure to catch these special shows all week on the CBN News channel beginning at noon Eastern. There are too many agencies and people in the federal government doing the same thing, and it's costing taxpayers, you and I, billions of dollars. That's the conclusion of a new report out today from the Nonpartisan Government Accountability Office. For example, it found there are 15 different agencies overseeing food safety, more than 20 separate programs to help the homeless, 47 different job training programs, and get this, more than 2,000 computer data centers. Republican Senator Tom Coburn said, quote, "This report confirms what most Americans assume about their government. We are spending trillions of dollars every year. Nobody knows what we are doing. The executive branch doesn't know. The congressional branch doesn't know. Nobody knows." As for the latest fight on spending cuts and the looming government shutdown, the House is set to pass a continuing resolution to keep the government running until March 18th. By then, they hope to have a long-term compromise with the White House.
The American people want us to get our fiscal house in order, and this is a step in the right direction. If American families can do with less, there's no reason why the government can't do with less.
The short-term fix trims about $4 billion in spending. A House committee wanted to hear from some governors today about President Obama's health care reform law. They got an earful from Mississippi governor and possible 2012 presidential contender Haley Barbour.
If that's what Massachusetts wants, we're happy for them. We don't want that. That's not good for us. We don't want that. We don't want community rating. We don't want extremely high mandatory standard benefits packages. So the point I'm trying to make is different states have different problems. We have different ideas. And while you may not believe it, some politicians, obviously, who act like y'all love our constituents more than we do. Believe it or not, we love our constituents as much as y'all do. And we want to do right for them, but we want to do what we can afford and can sustain.
The panel also heard from Massachusetts Governor Deval Patrick. The Democrat praised the new law, which is similar to what his state offers, and that plan was passed by another possible 2012 contender, then-Governor Mitt Romney. Today, Wisconsin Governor Scott Walker unveiled his two-year spending plan. It includes deep cuts for schools and city governments. His proposal will cut education aid by about $9 million. He says the cuts are needed to help close a $3.6 billion budget shortfall. 14 Wisconsin Senate Democrats are still protesting his proposal to take away nearly all collective bargaining rights for public workers. The senators are hiding out in Illinois to stop the vote. Another battle is looming in Congress, this time over government control of the internet. It's something known as net neutrality. The Federal Communications Commission has given itself authority to regulate internet content. Businesses don't like it, and Christian broadcasters are concerned it could restrict their ability to share the gospel online. This week, Republicans in the House are taking steps to override the FCC decision. House Speaker John Boehner tells CBN's David Brody this issue is a priority for him.
The idea that the federal government is going to police the internet is a solution looking for a problem. No one has ever been able to outline for me what the problem is that they want to create some solution for. And last winter, there's some in the Congress wanted to have to give the internet to the government temporarily to control it. And this is not a good idea. And I do expect that Congress very soon will speak very loudly on this issue.
You can find more of David's interview with Speaker Boehner at CBNNews.com. Maryland's legislature is racing to make it the sixth state to legalize gay marriage. Last week, the Senate approved the measure. It's now in the House where it's likely to pass. But as Paul Strand reports, the people of Maryland may throw a huge roadblock in the way.
The delegates could vote this week on a bill legalizing same-sex marriage.
This is about rights, respect, family, and love for everyone. No exceptions.
Nothing is more fundamental to human happiness than the right to find someone you love, to spend your life with them, raise children if you so choose, and love and be loved.
But then opponents say they'll immediately begin the process of gathering signatures to put the issue on the ballot in November 2012 and let Marylanders themselves decide whether they want to approve gay marriage. Delegate Don Dwyer is one of the opposition leaders.
We have the ground troops in place. We're just ready to give them the marching orders when necessary.
If you vote to legalize same-sex marriage, this issue will be placed on the ballot and your decision will be overturned by the people.
If the public has the opportunity to vote on this issue, which I believe they will, I believe they will reject it.
If the voters do throw out what their legislature has done, it won't be the first state where this has happened. Maine voters did the same thing in 2009. After the state legislature legalized same-sex marriage, voters put it on the ballot and then repealed the marriage law. In fact, every state that has voted on same-sex marriage has turned it down.
31 of 31 states, everywhere it's been put to a vote, marriage has been protected as the union of a man and a woman. If Proposition 8 passed in California and the people of California stood up to protect marriage, or Maine, which are also blue states, I have no doubt that you'll see the same in Maryland.
The Maryland legislature and the governor are likely to approve same-sex marriage, but the people of Maryland are also likely to have the final say on just what marriage will look like in their state. Paul Strand, CBN News, reporting from Annapolis, Maryland.
A Christian couple in Britain cannot be foster parents because they believe homosexuality is a sin. That's the ruling from a British court. Eunice and Owen Johns cared for foster children in the 1990s and applied to become foster parents again in 2007. But a social worker said their views on homosexuality raised concerns. A court declined to reinstate their application, ruling that a law protecting gay rights overrides the couple's religious beliefs. The Christian Legal Center reports the judges stated that Christian beliefs on homosexuality may be harmful to children. The group tells us this should be a wake-up call for Christians.
And we see very clearly in black and white what the whole agenda is. And we see very clearly that Christians are being marginalized and pushed out of the public sphere here in the United Kingdom. So I'm hoping that Christians, upon realizing that, will begin to fight back. The Christian people in the United States really have a presence. Their view, it seems to me, is still counted. But what I pray is that your church and your Christian voice will remain very, very strong. I pray that you will learn from what is going on here in the United Kingdom, and you will not let the beautiful United States of America go down this kind of track, descending into the secular liberal chaos that we find ourselves in here. Please don't let that happen.
Great advice, and we'll be right back.
Attention investors, now is the time to protect your retirement accounts and investments.
Excessive government spending is devaluing the U.S. dollar and high rates of inflation are coming. Gold has tripled since 2001 and some experts predict the prices will climb another 100%. Buy gold now, direct and wholesale with United Gold Group. The demand for gold around the world is higher than ever. Foreign countries like China and India are buying up gold at record rates. Why? What do they know that you don't?
Call now and get your Gold Investors Kit absolutely free. Call in the next 5 minutes and receive The Secret to Owning Gold in Your Retirement Account, also absolutely free. Just call 1-800-758-5070. That's 1-800-758-5070.
This could be the most important call you make this year. United Gold Group, investing in America's future. Attention investors, now is the time to protect your retirement accounts and investments.
Excessive government spending is devaluing the U.S. dollar and high rates of inflation are coming. Gold has tripled since 2001 and some experts predict the prices will climb another 100%.
Buy gold now, direct and wholesale with United Gold Group. The demand for gold around the world is higher than ever. Foreign countries like China and India are buying up gold at record rates. Why? What do they know that you don't?
Call now and get your Gold Investors Kit absolutely free. Call in the next 5 minutes and receive The Secret to Owning Gold in Your Retirement Account, also absolutely free. Just call 1-800-758-5070. That's 1-800-758-5070.
This could be the most important call you make this year. United Gold Group, investing in America's future.
Nine-year-old Esther had congestive heart failure and given only a few months to live. And that's when a unique Israeli organization stepped in to help. The group has saved thousands of children like Esther, both Christian and Muslim. Julie Stahl has the story from Israel.
These children look happy, healthy, and active. But just weeks ago, each one of them faced death. They needed open-heart surgery, and they got it through Save a Child's Heart in Israel.
The idea behind Save a Child's Heart is to provide life-saving heart surgery for children from developing countries.
That was the case with Esther, a Christian from the Maasai tribe in Tanzania. Rheumatic fever damaged her heart, and she couldn't get the necessary help in her own country. She became the 2,500th patient of Save a Child's Heart.
Her heart was huge. She was very limited in a very simple task. Even simple walking, it was difficult for her.
Sister Angelica runs the children's home where Esther lives. She heard about the program from a volunteer who just happened to be riding the same bus from Kenya to Tanzania. Angelica contacted Save a Child's Heart and learned a team was actually heading to Tanzania to climb Mount Kilimanjaro 2 days later. One of the doctors, Dr. Godwin Godfrey, is Tanzanian.
Actually, for me, it looks like a miracle.
They met Esther, saw she needed surgery urgently, and 2 months later, she was in Israel. Dr. Lior Sasson operated for hours, reconstructing the valve in Esther's heart.
Now she can live a normal life. She would have to take preventive medicine that her valve would not be affected again.
Executive Director Simon Fisher says more than 50% of the children treated have been Palestinian from the West Bank and the Gaza Strip.
We believe that Save a Child's Heart has a very positive message, which it sends out from Middle East, from Israel, about people working together from different nationalities and different religions for the best of our children.
Part of the program's goal is to train doctors from developing countries, like Dr. Godfrey, who will work in Israel for 5 years.
This training will be one of its kind for my country, so hopefully when I go back, I will actually start the open heart surgery also for the young children.
Before and after surgery, the children live in this house, usually with a parent or caregiver. House mother Laura Cassis says the change in the children is amazing.
You see the children going home healthy. You know, you see children that sometimes can barely walk, practically running to the gate and to the minibus to go to the airport, and they're smiling and they're looking forward to going home, and you know that they have a future.
Less than 2 weeks after her surgery, Esther was dancing with her newfound friends and sang us a song she sings at home.
I've got peace like a river, I've got peace. Like a river, love God is like a river in my soul.
Julie Stahl, CBN News, Holon, Israel.
What a wonderful program there. Up next, Feeding the Need. Christians in London make sure families get food for both their bodies and souls.
The doctor said to me, Peggy, you don't understand. Pancreatic cancer is inoperable and incurable. And he says, well, Peggy, you've got 2 months to live. It was like he was telling me, go to the store. There was no compassion. Yeah, it was heartbreaking. My life was an hourglass. I was home laying on the couch, just dying. My sister Pam called the Cancer Treatment Centers of America. When I got there, I knew that I was going to be cared for. I met with the doctor after the tests were done and said, how long do I have? And he looked at me and he said, Peggy, we did a lot of tests on you, and I never saw one thing stamped on the bottom of your foot that said you were going to die in 2 months. You have no expiration date. And I thought, wow.
Cancer Treatment Centers of America is unlike any other cancer hospital, full of hope, committed to your fight. We use every weapon, surgery, chemotherapy, radiation, nutrition, spiritual support, and mind-body medicine. We surround you with a real team, working together, all under one roof.
Each time I went back to the Cancer Treatment Centers of America, I responded better. My tumors were shrinking, came back in September again, and they still couldn't see anything. I said, you're kidding me. We'll see how it goes, we'll keep testing, but we can't see the tumors anymore.
Please call the number on your screen to speak with an oncology information specialist and receive a life-changing information kit and DVD packed with valuable information. Call now and learn about treatment options you may not even know exist.
It's really unbelievable how one doctor can tell me I have 2 months to live, and then I go to the Cancer Treatment Centers of America and they saved my life. Hope is a mainstay. Hope is everything.
Don't give up. Your fight is our fight. Call Cancer Treatment Centers of America today.
Parts of Ohio are bracing for flooding a day after strong storms killed at least 4 people in the eastern half of the country. 3 of those people were from Tennessee, where tornadoes destroyed homes. The storms also brought high winds and flooding to Kentucky, Ohio, and Indiana. Tens of thousands of people lost their electricity in at least 4 states. A self-help guru is on trial for manslaughter and the deaths of three people who died during one of his rituals. It was in Arizona in October of 2009 that James Arthur Ray told dozens of his followers to get into a sweat lodge packed with red-hot rocks. He told his followers it was a rebirthing experience. Instead, three people died and more than a dozen became sick. Ray's attorneys say the participants were well aware of the health risks and voluntarily took part in the ceremony. They say no one could have predicted the deaths. The weak economy is threatening families across the United Kingdom. Some even face the threat of homelessness and hunger. Many churches there are helping to bridge the gap. And UK correspondent Peter Wooding has the story from Salisbury, England.
As the UK continues to feel the bite of the recession, particularly after families will have accumulated even more debt over the Christmas season, shocking figures reveal 3.7 million children are living in poverty across the country. Mr. and Mrs. Sanford faced the threat of becoming homeless as they struggle to find work to meet their mounting debts and desperately try to feed their four children. Mr. Sanford said he was so desperate he nearly turned to crime.
The main challenge was putting food on the plate. We were just about keeping up with some of the bills, but we were looking at losing the house at the time. The only alternative would have been, you know, begging on the streets or crime to feed the family, you know.
But when the Trussell Trust intervened to feed the family, there was a dramatic turnaround. Now they found enough work to keep their home and care for their children.
Not only is there the actual food they'll bring to your house, but then they can put you in contact with other agencies, people that can help you out with the benefit questions or whatever, Citizens Advice Bureau and other things. And they got us through the hard times, you know.
And the Trussell Trust here in Salisbury in southwest England is mobilising churches right across the UK to set up food banks to help many more impoverished families. Last year alone, the Christian charity provided much needed food supplies for more than 40,000 people. Chris Mould, director of the Trussell Trust, explains why their food bank ministry is so vital.
There are more people than ever before in our society who do not know where to turn. They are making choices between heating the home and feeding the children, between paying the rent and getting a square meal. And quite often we meet people who've gone without food for several days.
Mould says the greatest rewards of their work are the fact that they're literally saving lives.
Highlights for us are when people say, you know, that thing you did for me saved my life. Now, that's not too strong a claim. We've met several people who have been at the point of utter despair, and it's the Christian community through the food bank that has been able to engage with them.
And one of those who'd reached that point of despair was former drug addict Jim Bugden, who suffered such extreme depression he tried to commit suicide three times. During Christmas, Jim didn't even eat for 2 weeks until a drug rehabilitation centre put him in touch with the Trussell Trust Church Food Bank.
And as I went down here, I was working terrifically. It felt as though it was in another world, if you know what I mean.
Peter Moss faced bullying in the workplace, lost his job and became homeless. Despite all of this, as well as suffering from cerebral palsy, he now faithfully serves as a volunteer at the Trussell Trust Food Bank in Salisbury. Moss sees this ministry as a way of practically demonstrating his Christian faith.
It makes you feel inside you. You've given some of the love of Jesus back to them. And we are, the Trussell is here to help people back to the good Lord.
So as the UK faces what's expected to be another tough year with the recession, the challenge remains for the church to respond to this crisis for the sake of the country's children. Peter Wooding for CBN News, Salisbury, England.
The church doing what it's supposed to do. Well, new crash tests show that the underride guards on 18-wheelers don't always prevent cars from going under the rear of the truck. That type of collision often results in the decapitation of the driver. The Insurance Institute for Highway Safety says the federal government needs to impose stricter standards for truck safety. Almost 80% of crashes that involve cars rear-ending trucks result in significant amounts of underride. Up next, not playing nice. One Pennsylvania pizza joint's evil plan to put their competition out of business.
The doctor said to me, Peggy, you don't understand. Pancreatic cancer is inoperable and incurable. And he says, well, Peggy, you've got 2 months to live. It was like he was telling me, go to the store. There was no compassion. Yeah, it was heartbreaking. My life was an hourglass. I was home, laying on the couch, just dying. My sister Pam called the Cancer Treatment Centers of America. When I got there, I knew that I was going to be cared for. I met with a doctor after the tests were done and said, how long do I have? And he looked at me and he said, Peggy, we did a lot of tests on you, and I never saw one thing stamped on the bottom of your foot that said you were going to die in 2 months. You have no expiration date. And I thought, wow.
Cancer Treatment Centers of America is unlike any other cancer hospital, full of hope, committed to your fight. We use every weapon, surgery, chemotherapy, radiation, nutrition, spiritual support, and mind-body medicine. We surround you with a real team, working together, all under one roof.
Each time I went back to the Cancer Treatment Centers of America, I responded better. My tumors were shrinking. Came back in September again, and they still couldn't see anything. I said, you're kidding me. We'll see how it goes. We'll keep testing, but we can't see the tumors anymore.
Please call the number on your screen to speak with an oncology information specialist and receive a life-changing information kit and DVD packed with valuable information. Call now and learn about treatment options you may not even know exist.
It's really unbelievable how one doctor can tell me I have 2 months to live. And then I go to the Cancer Treatment Centers of America and they saved my life. Hope is a mainstay. Hope is everything.
Don't give up. Your fight is our fight. Call Cancer Treatment Centers of America today.
Forget friendly competition. A pizza parlor owner in Pennsylvania is not playing nice with his competitors, and his tactics could put other local stores out of business.
We call it kind of tongue-in-cheek terrorism by mice or the Great Pizza Wars.
Police believe the pizzeria owner is behind a mice problem in two rival pizza chains right down the street from his. They caught the suspect dumping bags of live mice throughout the stores. Wow. First, he released them in the ceiling of one restaurant, then ran across the street and placed them in the trash cans of another.
It's insane. It's crazy. I've never heard of anything like that. I've never witnessed anything like that. He goes to the bathroom, and I heard like a noise going on in the bathroom. I thought it was just him banging around or something. So I just checked after he walked out of the bathroom, and there was footprints on the toilet seat.
This is outrageous. Yeah. How could anyone do this? This is how I feed my kids.
That's ridiculous. The suspect claims his competitors started the rivalry by dropping mice on his property first. Look at those mice. That's just creepy. His stunt earned him criminal mischief and animal cruelty charges. But the mice are doing okay. Well, that's all for this edition of NewsWatch. Remember, you can email us your comments and questions at newswatch@cbn.com. We hope you'll join us next time. Have a great day.